When the more than 240,000 residents, homes, businesses, and industries in the Eugene-Springfield area turn on a faucet or flush the toilet, what goes down the drain flows through pipelines and pump stations until it arrives here at the Eugene-Springfield Water Pollution Control Facility.
So what comes into the plant is 99.9% water, 0.1% pollutants, and we remove about 98% of that 0.1%. And this ends up being what we end up putting back in the river. The main job here is protecting the environment and doing the best we can to give the ratepayer their best bang for their buck.
Pumps, screens, clarifiers, and digesters remove materials and pollutants from 38 million gallons of wastewater every day, which is enough to fill 106 Olympic-sized swimming pools. Ensuring the clean water meets environmental standards before it's discharged into the Willamette River is the plant's first priority.
We've got federal and Oregon environmental parameters that we have to meet, so that's our number one priority. Then we're able to look at doing that in the most cost-effective way we can, and energy management has been a long time ingrained into our system here.
Water treatment plants account for up to 4% of the power being consumed in any given community. At the Eugene-Springfield plant, a key step in the treatment involves mixing oxygen with good bacteria. This process dissolves and absorbs organic matter and requires a massive amount of energy.
The biggest energy using process is the activated sludge system, where we have turbo blowers actually taking the air that we're breathing and blowing it up into the wastewater and bubbling it up and getting oxygen for the bacteria to utilize the organics. It uses about 50 to 60% of our power here on site.
As part of a recent project with Eugene Water and Electric Board and Bonneville Power Administration, the Metropolitan Wastewater Management Commission upgraded the facility's blower system.
These blowers are two cores, and so you can ride up and down the power curve and get the appropriate flows. Whereas older units, they're really more of an on-off kind of thing. It's give me 1,000 horsepower at this, you know, flow rate and this pressure or nothing. Well, in here, they get better functionality out of their system, and that gives us, as a demand response tool, visibility and controllability that we didn't have before. So instead of turning things on and off and jerking the system around, you can slowly bring the system back on, for example. And so this energy efficiency project actually allowed us more flexibility for demand response.
Although relatively new to the Northwest, demand response is regarded as a tool that can add flexibility and reliability to the power grid management equation. Facilities that use equipment with controls to run energy-intensive processes are candidates for demand response.
This unit, which is producing 800 kilowatts, is now producing more than enough power to run the entire plant. Effectively, we're putting power onto the grid now, rather than drawing power off the grid. This engine generator is one of the reasons we can do this kind of exercise very successfully.
As part of the pilot project, the facility was put through a series of tests to find out if it could drop its energy load, keep it at a minimum level for an hour or longer, and do so within 10 minutes.
10 minutes, we needed to get as much load off of the plant as we could. So the first thing that we would do is hit the blower, because that's the big ticket item. The blower has two cores in it, and so for long duration periods, we would turn the blower off, and then we would deactivate the second core, so only one core could start, and so that would get us through 4-hour events.
Once we shut off that big blower, things go fairly fast. It makes power shed a lot easier.
This isn't a speedboat, you know, it's more like that big oil freighter going across the ocean. You know, you turn off all the power, it's still going to keep going forward for quite some time before it comes to a stop. And so when you start adjusting air flows and dissolved oxygen levels, you do it incrementally and you do it slow, and you watch for the outcome before you move to the next level down.
Results revealed that the plant's processes could be interrupted or delayed for an hour, and sometimes up to 4, without negative impacts.
I could see where it could easily become a routine operational task, because we were able to stay way within our permit parameters while going through all the exercises.
With over 1,000 in the region, wastewater facilities represent a significant group of potential demand response assets.
The bigger picture with demand response is a customer is in partnership with the utility to balance demand and supply. And so we're entering kind of a new era, and we're trying to partner to get that least cost, reliable power that we that fuels our economy and powers our phones and tablets.
Demand response also provides economic benefits to grid operators and utilities, which translates to cost-saving opportunities for businesses and facilities.
The power will be used at a different time of the day rather than the peak period when we're having to go out and get power from resources other than hydro. So there's an advantage to the power provider, and if we can share in that advantage, then I would see it being a good opportunity for the community to save money and a real good mesh of industries.